Just before Jesus ascended, he said, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. For he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. They shall cast out devils in my name. They shall speak in new tongues." New tongues. 10 days later, it is written, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven like as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the room where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Holy Spirit gave them utterance. Foretold in the Old Testament, promised again to them by Jesus Christ, this gift of the Holy Ghost was poured out upon them on Pentecost. The sin of the plain of Shinar that had scattered men and their languages one from another. Men at the Tower of Babel in rebellion against God could no longer break down the barriers with their fellow man. What man had done in his sin, only God the Holy Ghost could overcome. You people ought to know that nobody has conquered the language barrier between nations as the Christian church has with her missionaries and translators. And that's what they said, these pilgrim Jews of Jerusalem at the time. These people who had come from every corner of the earth for Pentecost. They heard and saw these things goings on and say, amazed and astonished, are not these men Galileans? How hear we every man them speak in our own tongues wherein we were born? For we do hear them speak in our tongue the wonderful works of God. That special gift of speaking in foreign languages, that gift given to that early church in rich measure, that gift God gave lavishly, liberally, to the congregation at Corinth. I don't know why. Maybe because they were a cosmopolitan area, a crossroads of the world at that time, a citadel of commerce in the ancient Mediterranean area. I don't know why either, that of all the gifts God gave these people, they prized this one more than any other. Unless it was a simple case of peacock feathers, standing up in the assembly, speaking in a foreign tongue, drawing attention to self and saying, look at me. Or maybe it was not evilly intentioned at all. Maybe because God gave them this gift, when they really felt a thing, heartfelt thanks, for example, and they got up to speak and to sing about it, maybe it came out in the tongue that they loved best. I know this happens with our grandmothers, that when they pray, when they go into surgery, they still pray the prayers that they learned as little children in their mother tongue. Our missionaries in Japan do the same thing. When they are in earnest wrestling with God, they do not pray in Japanese. They pray in the language that they love the best, English, our American dialect. So, like people throughout the ages, they took one gift of God, exaggerated, blew it all out of proportion. They it and promoted it. Well, how many times hasn't this happened in church history? Sincere and well-intentioned people take one doctrine, like the Lord's word on poverty, or celibacy, or temperance, or baptism, and twist it till you can hardly recognize the truth. Sometimes it isn't even the truth anymore. Chapter 12, God, Paul told them that all their spiritual gifts had the same source, the Holy Spirit. Chapter 13, Paul gave them the glue that kept all of these gifts together, Christian love. Now, in chapter 14, Paul puts that gift of speaking in tongues, this amazing ability of linguistics, languages, he puts that gift in its proper perspective. And he begins in a way that you're not looking for. He doesn't say to them, stop it. Forget about that gift of God. We like that. There's something legalistic about us that wants a religion of stop this, stop that, touch not, taste not, handle not. Our rules and regulations, as though the trouble always were out there somewhere. When the Bible always teaches that it's not the use of God's gifts, it's the abuse of them. That it isn't all these wicked things that got to be put away. It's your wicked attitude toward them that's got to be changed, converted, and turned around. Follow after charity. Desire spiritual gifts, but rather that you may prophesy, Paul begins. He's speaking to people like you and me, who are easily excuse ourselves saying, oh, I don't have a gift in that area. I'm sorry, I would like to help out, but that simply isn't my talent. Pursue it. Desire it. Follow after it. Pray for it and practice it. Maybe you'll get it. Paul tells them. But the main gift of all is prophesying. Unfortunate that that word is not translated correctly into English. Prophecy is a person who preaches or proclaims publicly. But in the wide sense, the sense in which it's meant here, to prophesy simply means to tell us, talk it, testify of the message of God. Speak up! Speak out! Speak forth the wonderful works of God. People, don't you understand? He's putting this gift of simply telling somebody of their Savior and of the judgment to come, a thing that every last one of you can do. He puts that gift highest of all in the church. The reason for it, he says, that it's a much to be preferred gift than knowing the ancient languages like Greek and Hebrew and being called to a professorship at the seminary. Is he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh unto God, for no man understandeth him. But he that prophesieth speaketh unto men to edify them, to exhort them, to comfort them. So, the man who speaks in a foreign language, he knows what he's talking about. God knows what he is talking about. But nobody else knows what he's talking about. And the point and purpose of Christians gathering together is to edify, to enlighten, to instruct, to strengthen, establish, and settle people's hearts and minds, to build up the people of God into eternity, that this world with all its wiles cannot tear you down. That's the point. Now, he that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifieth himself. There's some good in this, communicating with God, unfortunately. If it's in an unknown tongue, nobody else profits by it. But he that prophesies edifies the church. His gift is superior because it includes more than himself. It draws into the sphere of God's concern and love somebody else also. I would that you all speak with tongues, isn't it? Not? I begrudge you people these gifts, but rather that you people prophesy. For greater is he that prophesieth than he that speaketh in tongues, except he interpret, that the church may be edified. The only occasion in which foreign language would be of any value is if some teacher, some interpreter is there to explain the meaning to you. I can recall from seminary days what a joy it was. Old Professor Meyer, who could think and speak Greek, how he could take us boys through the New Testament and listen to him explain that. That's a gift. But now, brethren, two examples. Whether pipe or harp, except you give distinct sounds, how shall I know what is pipe or harp? If the pipe and the harp and the tuba and the trombone all sound the same, it'll sound like a Chinese orchestra or like the New York Philharmonic warming up. I can't get any tune out of it, no melody. Second example. If the trumpet give an uncertain sound, how shall the soldier get ready for battle? If all that man in the trenches hears is a loud blaring, a trumpet sounding, but he cannot tell whether it's retreat or whether it's reveille, whether it's tapped or whether it's attacked. What good is the sound of the trumpet then? The man doesn't know which way to go. So likewise ye, except it be in words, easy to understand. What is the point of your speaking in tongues? It is like talking into the air. Take me, for example. If I pray with the Spirit and sing with the Spirit, Paul says, perhaps I am preaching the most marvelous sermon ever spoken. I get it. God gets it. The holy angels themselves are in rapt admiration of that sermon. But none of you people get it. What good is that in the church? Take yourself for an example, he says. Let's say that you stand up in the group and begin to praise God for some great blessing in your life, for something he's done to you personally. But you do it in your native tongue, a foreign tongue. How can anybody else in the room say amen to that prayer? They don't know what you're talking about. The point is, seek those gifts which help the others. Prayers, preaching, singing, sermons, which build up the saints of God. I thank my God, I speak with more tongues than any of you. Yet in the church, I had rather speak five words with my understanding, that by my voice I might teach the church, than 10,000 words in a tongue that nobody understands. Plain talk and with understanding. He's telling you people here a very treasured tool that you do not have to check your brains at the door to become a Christian. Our fathers always knew that. Have you ever noticed how little stock the old-timers put in the revival type of religion? This foot-stamping, hand-clapping, hallelujah shouting. Our fathers always said, when you pull up the tent stakes and move on, the religion goes right along with it. Our fathers were very suspicious of this excited, ecstatic emotionalism, this mass psychology, this frenzied hysteria, this spouting of pious cliches and obscure theology. Our Father said we are to love God with all our hearts and with all our souls, but also with all of our minds, that the teachings of the true God can bear up under careful scrutiny, under the searchlight of investigation. That I do not have to promote you people with all kinds of mob psychology so that you never get to asking any question. Oh, no, sir. I want you to think, to use your God-given reason, intellect, mind, and understanding. You will have nothing to be ashamed of. In fact, the teachings of God's Word will elevate you, not degrade you. Use your mind. And it's true. If your religion is one of these hallelujah, frenzied, emotional, shouting things up on the mountain peaks, what happens to you the rest of the time? When a man loses his wife, someone suffers a personal setback in his life, or when a patient agonizes in pain, where is all that emotionalism now? We do not live on the mountaintops, most of the time on the plain, and sometimes even in the depths. There is something about our religion, that of Jesus Christ our Lord, that even a child can plumb the depths. All these little ones love to turn their face to him like a sunflower to the sun. But also, men of great mental ability have found nothing in Jesus Christ to be ashamed of. Isaac Newton, the mathematician. Gustavus Adolphus, the soldier. Michael Faraday, the physicist. J.P. Morgan, the industrialist and financier. Johann Sebastian Bach, the musician. Daniel Webster, the American statesman. They too loved their religion because they did not have to quit thinking. They could use their powerful gift of intellect and grow in God's grace also. No doubt, at night, or when the last shadows draw near, the small child and the great philosopher pray the same prayer. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray thee, Lord, my soul to keep. And in the dark, the chubby little hand, as well as the wrinkled and arthritic hand, both reach out for the good shepherd and his hand. With your understanding, and no hysteria in the name of religion will ever replace that. You think of that when you watch these healing shows on TV. Now, so much for you. There is another aspect, and that's about the outsider, the unbeliever, the unconverted. Paul says, I know you people are impressed with your gift of tongues. But I want to use an example from the Old Testament to tell you how little, really, outsiders are impressed by what you have. It is written in the law, with men of other tongues and with other lips will I speak unto them, and yet for all that will they not listen to me, saith the Lord. Remember how God warned the people of Judah? Again and again he sent mighty prophets to them to tell them to repent of their sins, turn again to their God. You know what happened? Nothing. Then God would speak to them in a language they would understand. The language of the rod, the language of punishment. He sent upon them the Assyrian hordes who stamped through their streets, ravaged their houses. And what do you think happened when they heard the babbling of soldiers' tongues in the streets in an Assyrian language? Do you think they repented? Forget it. Outward miracles don't win anybody. Jesus said, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And people who will not listen to the plain preaching of God's word will not be converted, though the whole cemetery rose up from the dead. So, you people may appreciate God's gift. Baptism, Lord's Supper, your lovely liturgy, your architecture. But let me tell you, the outsider doesn't. You may think it a miracle that your catechism in 450 years is the only textbook that has never been improved upon. The outsider wrinkles his nose at that. Because what would happen? He comes in here, you people are all enraptured of your spiritual gifts. This one jabbering, that one praying, this one singing. You think you're going to impress him? No, sir. You think you're all crazy. Must be some sort of lunatic asylum on the corner of St. Paul and Avon. But if you tell him, if you preach him, if you simply talk it to him, don't argue, don't apologize, don't attack. Tell him what God means in your life. Then his own heart will be pricked with his guilt. His own eyes will see where he stands before God. His own mind will corroborate every single thing in God's word is true. And where an unbeliever fights that invisible battle, another outward effect will come to pass. He too will bow down before the same God that you and confess the same scripture as enduring truth. But people, you got to do it. Don't you foster a clergy-centered religion. Don't you follow the footsteps of the Pope, who has the professional church workers do all of the important things. The common herd just kicks in with the money. Don't you do that. You do the most important thing of all. Best tell others of the wonderful works of God. Look back in your own life, as I can look back in my life. Who was it who first spake to me of the God to whom I owed my all? It wasn't a missionary, and it wasn't a preacher who first told me, come and see me. Do it. And if you people will always keep this principle in mind, and you will fight off anything and everything from within and without that sidetracks you from edifying the church, from building up the people of God, then everything else, I think, in our church will fall in proper order. Somebody wants to talk in tongues? Yes, if there's an interpreter. Several want to talk in tongues, no more than three. We don't want to spend a whole day at this sort of thing. If there is no interpreter there to tell what the man speaking in tongues is talking about, forget it. Let him cool his heel till somebody does appear. You preachers, same thing. No more than three. That's about all the sermons anybody can stand. For God is the God of peace and not of confusion. You probably noticed, if you do your homework the way you're told, we left out a very touching and timely part of this chapter, the role of the woman. That, God willing, we will save to next week, when we will give it our full attention. Amen.